Good evening, and welcome to County Connections here on BCTV. I'm Jonathan DelCollo, your host for this show. I am the Prothonotary of Berks County, and we're going to talk about a little bit about the office tonight, but a lot about a lot of the historic records that we house in the office and that are available to researchers throughout Berks County and throughout the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and even the United States and the world as a whole. For those of you who might not know what the Prothonotary is, the Prothonotary is an elected row office, and the Prothonotary is the chief clerk and record keeper of the family and civil divisions of the Court of Common Pleas of Berks County. Long title. I handle everything that's civil and family, nothing criminal. Our clerk of courts handles criminal. The Prothonotary handles anything that's civil. We record things like divorces and custodies and civil actions, tort actions. We also record liens, federal tax liens, state tax liens, municipal liens, things like that. We also are a passport agent for the United States Department of State, and we also file and record protection from abuse orders in our office. So that's a little bit about the office. Tonight, I'd like to talk about some of our very historic records. Since I was elected last year, one of my primary goals has been to digitize our very old historic records and preserve them for the generations that come after me and us. Berks County, as many of us know, was founded March 11th, 1752. We are an old county, and we have very old records, and the records that we do have need to be preserved. So last year, began a digitization project in my office, digitizing primarily our records going from March of 1752 up to about 1900, and we're just about done with that, and we're very proud. We're about at 350,000 pages of images that we've done in about a year and a half, so we're really proud. And I brought along with me tonight a few of our historic records that I'd like to share with you and just tell you about. And they're very interesting. I'm a history nerd, so I love Berks County's history, and I hope that you will too. We're going to delve into these, and I'll talk about each one as they come up. So if we can go to slide one, which I think I have up right now. Okay, that's great. This is a writ, an old writ from February of 1753. Now, Berks County at this time was only about 11 months old. We weren't even a year old. And first thing you're going to notice about this is you see the name George II, by the grace of God of Great Britain, France, and Ireland, King Defender of the Faith. We were not the United States of America yet in 1753, as we all know from the history books. We were still a colony of Great Britain. So George II was still the ruler of the ultimate ruler of Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania still had a legislature. Pennsylvania had a governor, a legislature. But George II was the ultimate sovereign and ruler of the American colonies. So his name went on all the writs at this time. This is a writ in a lawsuit between a gentleman named George Dollinger versus a gentleman by the name of Englehart Florey, F-L-O-R-Y. And he's suing him for, Mr. Dollinger is suing Mr. Florey for £14, 15 shillings, and 10 pence. And this is basically a writ directing the sheriff of Berks County to find Englehart Florey, the defendant in this case, and bring him to Reading to stand before the Court of Common Pleas that will be held on the 8th day of May 1753, and for George, for Englehart Florey to answer for this charge that's been made against him by Mr. Dollinger. It's witnessed by a gentleman named John Potts, and John Potts was an early judge of Berks County. And it's signed by James Reed, and James Reed was the very first Prothonotary of Berks County. I'm the 56th in the long history of Berks County, and James Reed was like the George Washington of Berks County. I mean, he set everything. He held all the offices. When Berks County was founded, James Reed was everything. He was the Prothonotary. He was the Clerk of Courts. He was the Register of Wills, the Recorder of Deeds. He did it all because Berks County was just getting off the ground. It was a very infant county. What's very interesting about this, other than it mentions George II. Now, George II was the father of King George III, who we broke away from during the Revolution. But it doesn't give at the very end, it says, issued the 16th day of February in the 26th year of our reign. So they always use the royal we or the royal our, the 25th year of King George II's reign. He began his reign over Great Britain in June of 1727. So this is the 25th year of his reign. They didn't make it easy to calculate the month and the year back then. So this is a very interesting writ, just an example of something that you would find in our old historic records. So I'm gonna bring up another one here, which is a little different, and this is even more historic. This is slide 2. And this is actually a subpoena. And this is from 1760, which Berks was about 8 years old back then. And this was a case of a gentleman named Peter Faust versus another gentleman named Peter Haas. And what's interesting about this is it lists a whole bunch of people that are commanded to come to Berks County, to Reading, to provide testimony in the case of Mr. Faust versus Mr. Haas. What's interesting, again, with this is it was issued in the 33rd year of King George II's reign, and it was actually his last year. King George II died in October of 1760. So this is probably one of the last writs or subpoenas. This is a subpoena. One of the last subpoenas issued in Berks County, I guess before they got wind of George II's death, because they didn't have email or texts or FaceTime back then, instantaneous news. So they were probably still issuing writs under George II's name even after he had died, before they got word that George II was buried and that George III, his son, had succeeded him. We were still a colony, of course, in 1760. James Reed was still the Prothonotary. But the interesting name on this is... And you'll see them. You'll see his name at the second to last line of this subpoena, and he was the witness on this. And his name was Conrad Weiser, and everybody in Berks County knows Conrad Weiser. Some of us have graduated from Conrad Weiser High School. Conrad Weiser, the eminent jurist, one of Berks County's most eminent personalities. He was the first president judge of Berks County, but he was the witness on this subpoena back in 1760. So very interesting piece of history. And of course, I love how this is the process of getting these digitized. If you look closely, you can see some lines at the top, almost a quarter of the way through this document. These writs and subpoenas were folded in sections of four. And the vendor that's helping us to scan these, these were all painstakingly unfolded. Some of them probably hadn't been unfolded for at least a century, I would think. And we used archival tape to make sure that any parts that were tearing apart and any words that were separated, that we could very carefully tape them together with archivally safe tape to preserve the paper, so that these high-quality images could be done. So we're really proud of the way that these images have come out. Very, very cool. So I brought along one more writ, And this is our slide three, and this is from 1762, August of 1762. Well, this is a little different at the top. Now it says George III, by the grace of God of Great Britain and France and Ireland and King Defender of the Faith. So now we have the new king. He was in the second year of his reign. He became king of, upon George II's death in 1760, October of 1760. This is a case of a gentleman named Samuel Weiser. Maybe he had a relation to Conrad Weiser. We really don't know. Versus a gentleman named Adam Lang. And Mr. Weiser suing Mr. Lang for £40. This is a writ. And it's very similar to the first one that we saw, where is the judge who signed this writ, a judge by the name of Francis Parvin, another early eminent jurist in Berks County's history, basically commanding the sheriff to take Mr. Lang into his person, as they call it, and keep, it says here, and safely keep that you have in his body before our justices at Reading in our county court of common pleas. So this is a writ for Mr. For the sheriff of Berks County to take Mr. Lang and present him before the court so that he can answer to Mr. Weiser's charges. Again, James Reed is the Prothonotary. He signs in the lower right-hand corner. And there's something I forgot to mention earlier. You can probably notice the faint, there was a seal on the left of the writ. And that was usually a wax seal done by Mr. Reed. Over the years, it almost certainly had deteriorated. They captured as much as of it that they could when they imaged these. But very, very interesting. Berks was 10 years old, only 10 years old. And of course, we were still a colony, 1762. It wasn't for another 14 years before we became a nation. So very interesting types of records that we have from when Pennsylvania and Berks County was still a colony. You know, good, interesting types of records that we have. These are our historical records, and they're accessible to come into the office and research, and we'll get into that at the very end. I also brought along another whole type of more modern record that a lot of the researchers come and visit us for. And these are naturalization records. In the early, late 19th and early 20th centuries, many, many immigrants were coming to the United States. They wanted to become citizens, and they went through the process. There were two ways of becoming a citizen. You could naturalize at your county court, or you could naturalize in the federal court. And some people from Berks County would go down to Philadelphia, and they naturalized in federal court in Philadelphia. But a lot naturalized through the county court here in Berks. And I brought a petition for naturalization from 19, and I forget this is, and I should know this because this is 1928. This is my great uncle Anthony DelCollo. Who better to give an example of a naturalization petition than my great uncle? Great man. He lived a long life. I got to know him very well. Unfortunately, my grandfather, who was born in the United States, died when he was a young man. So I never got to meet him, but he was born in the United States, so he was a citizen. Uncle Tony was born in Italy, and he had to naturalize because he wanted to vote and he wanted to participate in America. So he went through this, the naturalization process. What's very interesting with this is, and this is where a lot of researchers come to me and they say, oh, I've done all my research. I know all my immigrants. I know when they came to America or about the time they came to America. I just can't find where they came from in the old country, they would say, or where they came from in Europe, or where they came from in South America, or wherever they came to America from. The naturalization records usually are the records that open the key for them to do further research in those countries. And if you take a look at this, what's immediately interesting is Of course, it gives basic vital information, his name, where he's living, his profession, when he was born and where he was born. So immediately you know he was born in this Villa Magna, Italy. It's a little village right near the Adriatic Sea. That's where our family comes from. But then you start to get in. So right there and then you say, oh, okay, I got the village. So you can easily go on do a search for Villa Magna. It'll show you where it is in Italy. It'll give you, nowadays it's wonderful because you can get information about the types of records that they have. But then this, when I originally researched this, this is what hit home for me, because you watch all these movies and you see everything about Ellis Island, and everybody thinks that their ancestors came through Ellis Island. Well, there was a lot of ports in the United States that people came through. Philadelphia was a port, of course, New York, Ellis Island was a port. There was ports all along the East Coast. New Orleans was a big port, San Francisco. So not everybody's immigrant ancestors came through Ellis Island. But when I saw this, that he immigrated from the United States from Naples, Italy, on or about October the 1st, 1912, and entered the United States at the port of New York. Well, that immediately tells me that that's Ellis Island. On the 18th of October, 1912, on the vessel Taormina. Very, very big information there. Name of the ship, name of the port. And then I looked at this and I said to myself, wow, 17-day journey on a boat. Probably had never even seen a boat before. And here they're on a 17-day journey. Then I found the village and I found Naples. They had to travel entirely across the Italian peninsula just to get to the ship. It really expands your story and it really makes you think about what, and gives you a great appreciation of what our immigrant ancestors did to come to America and to have a good life. As it goes further down, let me see here. It's a long document, so I couldn't fit it all on the same page. There's always witnesses at the bottom. And there was two witnesses that basically say to the judges, yeah, this is a good man, and he's worthy of being a citizen. So it's usually guys from the neighborhood, and I think these were friends of his. And they attest to his character as a witness. And they get accepted. They make the petition to the court, and I'm bringing up here another slide, slide 5, which is the second page of this naturalization petition. And they have to take an oath of allegiance. So if you see here, he renounces any fidelity to Victor Emmanuel III, King of Italy, who was the sovereign of the Italian Republic at that time. So he renounces any allegiance to King Victor Emmanuel III, and he is sworn in as a new American citizen. He gives a signature there. Sometimes you'll see an X. If you see an X, that usually means, almost always means, that the immigrant could not read or write, that they were illiterate. Uncle Tony could write his name, so he was pretty smart. Underneath that is attested to by the deputy prothonotary, and that signature there is very, very important. That was Paul Adams. He was the naturalization clerk for many, many years in Berks County, and he eventually went on to become the prothonotary of Berks County and served very honorably. So I always like those types of records. When I see his signature, it's a way for me to appreciate his service to the county as well. So those are naturalization records. We have them in the office. So if you think your immigrant ancestor might have naturalized in Berks County, or you know that they did, and you want to research these, please come to the office or get in touch with us. And we have a new feature here. I'm very into technology. And what I just put on the screen here is, or what the good folks here at BCTV did for me to put on the screen, is this slide where we now have a mobile app. So you can go to the App Store or the Android, I forget what that's called because I'm an Apple guy, the Android Google Store or something, but it was made for that too. And that's what our app looks like. It's called the Berks Prothonotary app. And there's a whole bunch of stuff on the Berks Prothonotary app. That's my screensaver, my wallpaper. I have the courthouse because I'm a Berks County history nerd. So that's my screen when I took the picture. And this was a screenshot I took of the app. There we go. And it has a nice little picture, and it'll give you the temperature. But then as you go down, and I'll scroll down a little bit here, just to give you some of the functionality that we have. Whoops. Okay, there we go. There we go, we got. So you can, there's a little video that I made welcoming to the office. If you want to ask me a question, you can do that. You can search our dockets, our current from 1996 forward. You can also log into our e-filing system from there. We have a lot of information about history and genealogy. You can search our databases. If you think you might have an ancestor that that naturalized, you can search there. We have a whole section for passports. We have a big section for protection of abuse and family court, because we have a lot of people that need help filing different types of family court petitions and things like that. And protection from abuse, of course, you know, I'm a big proponent of assisting domestic abuse victims as much as possible. So I worked with Berks Women in Crisis, a great local organization, to develop that section of the app. And under more, there's links, there's stuff about our office, hours. So it's a really handy little tool for using our office. So in the remaining time I have left here, I think I got one more thing I just want to put up here, and that's just some contact information about the office. So it's basically, there's our phone number. We, of course, have a county website. We're on Facebook, so I invite you to check out our Facebook page. I think the last count we had about 355 followers. We're also on Twitter. I love Twitter. I think it's a great way to connect with our customers, with people that are interested in local history. So I put little tidbits up there. I put pictures. I put stuff about the office, little history tidbits. I do that on Facebook and Twitter. And if you want to email me directly, there's my email address. I'll respond to you. I'll get back to you. I like to get back to my emails within 24 hours. It's usually same day, depending on when you send the message. So I want to thank everybody for joining us tonight, and thank you so much, and have a good night, and please keep watching BCTV. It's a great community resource. Thanks.